Welcome, everyone, and thanks very much for coming, taking the time. I'm Sean McDonough. I'm the current president of the Hamilton Golf and Country Club. I've been on the board for 7.5 years, and I'm halfway through my presidency this year. It's been a busy year, but I'm so pleased to be involved with the Canadian Open and our future golf course improvement plan. On my left is Chris Hamill, past president of the golf club. He was very influential in drawing up the golf course improvement plan, and he's been a great guy to follow through for the last 7.5 years, for sure.
Thank you, sir.
Fantastic. And on my far right, Rod Trainer, our superintendent of 30 years now. Rod has, he's retiring in December 31st, 2019, but luckily he has acquiesced and he's going to stick around for another year as our project manager in our new project. Right, Roddy?
You got it.
And so he's, as a project manager, he's starting, after the Open, and his junior superintendent, Jordan Kitchen, he is going to elevate into a full superintendent's role, and for the next year anyways, and we look forward to that, because Jordan has been well trained by Rod for sure, and he knows this golf course not quite as well as Rod, but he's doing a fantastic job, and we're happy to see Jordan is sticking around in the role as head superintendent. And on my right here is Martin Ebert, our architect, who has been advising us over the last 4 or 5 years on a potential project to the golf course. We're happy to have him here today to give you an update on how we got here, and Martin is going to go out in the golf course and, just see how it plays with the pros today. So, without further ado, I think we're going to Chris now, just to give an update on how we got to this point.
Thank you, Sean.
Yeah.
So I think I'll give everyone a bit of background on how we got to the golf course improvement plan. As a starting point, we're very proud to have a world-class golf course that we have. So when you're thinking about any project, you want to make sure you have some world-class help. So it's been phenomenal to have Martin Hebert on board as our course architect. He's been on board since 2014. And of course, having Rod as our superintendent and Jordan as his assistant superintendent, we've got great knowledge, great institutional knowledge about our course and about world-class facilities. So it was great to have that advisory through the process. But it's been a great and I think very constructive process over the last 2 years. We've got a very engaged membership, so we've been able to receive a lot of feedback over the last few years on priorities, interests, concerns, etc. And we've been able to bring all of that into the process. And I think one of the parts that I felt was really rewarding is with a lot of the components that could have been available, we really went to the basics, went back to the drawing board to ensure what should this project include. So for some of the advice, some of the conceptual ideas from a few years back, we looked at 3 primary options. We knew we had some aging infrastructure. We knew we needed to look at the bunkers and our irrigation system. So we had an option that really got us to that base scale, that base scope of bunkers and irrigation only. Then we came up with a second option that looked at some further enhancements that would include some tee blocks, not just for the long players that are playing here this week, but also for the members, the average, and the playing it forward type concepts. Then we also included a third option that included full green reconstruction. So when we looked at the 3 options, we also wanted to look at what are different approaches in terms of implementing the project. So we're very lucky here at Hamilton Golf and Country Club. We have full 27 playing holes. So we have some flexibility on how we can stage our projects through the course. So we looked at, can we just go through, essentially, not close the course, but give our contractor the ability to work on as many holes as he want to reduce the time frame. So that was one of our approaches. A second approach was really to control the work on the holes to ensure that we had at least 18 holes playable for our members as we went through the project. a third option where we could close 9 holes at a time, so spread that over 3 years. And then a fourth where can we control the work in the shoulder seasons and really leave the golf course open during the summers. So when we worked through all 3 options and all 4 approaches and all those permutations and combinations, we felt that there was a great opportunity here to tackle the full project. So we thought with a lot of the advice that we'd been given on where we could take our greens and the efficiency we would gain by completing that work in combination with the bunkers and irrigation. And then we look at further enhancements, whether it's forward tees, back tees, different locations for cart paths. There's some great design features that Martin has brought forward for us. That there really, it came very clear to us that being able to complete this project all together, including the greens, as well as doing it as quickly as possible and really within about 18 months, it was a great opportunity. Plus, it would still leave our members playing this course while that work is happening. And if we start this project in the fall of this year and carry through in 2020, we can really get our championship course, which we would tackle first, the West-South Nines. They would be back growing before the end of next year and be ready to have the pros see the new course back in 2023. So there are so many things lining up for us that we're really excited to see it come together. And we're excited to showcase that new golf course with Martin's touches and a little bit of that Harry Colt heritage brought back for these pros to enjoy in 2023. So that's the history. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Chris. Martin, I forgot to mention, Martin is a global expert on Harry Colt design golf courses. There are 2 in Canada, Toronto Golf and Hamilton Golf and Country. And since Martin has been coming back and forth to our course, he's got some great ideas to kind of bring our course back to a total Harry Colt design. And he also has designed Goodwood, just east of Toronto, a very good golf course, private golf course. And you've done some renovations at Angus Glen.
Angus Glen.
Indeed. Anything else?
Redtail, my partner, designed.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
okay.
In London.
Didn't know that.
Some years
it's another
ago.
Beautiful golf course. Yeah.
Yeah. Indeed. Yep.
So, anyways, I'll give you Ebert now.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, lovely to be here on such an auspicious week. I think when we first were asked by the club to have a look at the project, it excited us the fact that it was a Harry Colt design, one of the very few in North America. And I think it was great to hear the club's brief as well, that they really wanted to restore some of the great ideals that that Harry Colt practiced throughout his career. So with all of these projects, we love to study the history of them, look at the old plans, and that was great that the club did have the old Harry Colt sketches. There's not that many clubs which would have that resource available to them. We look at the old aerial photography as well, just to see how the courses have changed over the years. But I guess it quickly became apparent that when Harry Colt designed the course in 1914, he was here for a very limited period. Then the First World War intervened. So he left a fantastic layout out here, but I guess we've always said that he wasn't around and his people weren't really around to ensure that the detail matched the great layout. His partner, Charles Hugh Allison, came along in 1920 to look at the course after the war. He did all of the company's work then in North America after the war. And he said, done a great job in implementing Harry Colt's layout plans. That's great, but there could be a little bit of attention to detail improved with greens and bunkers in particular. So I guess that has sort of happened a little bit through the years, but in a piecemeal way. So I think it's great that the committee and the club have decided now to go forward and really have one major project to get that get that side of the project exactly as it should be, so that we think that if Harry Colt came back today, that he would be very proud of what will result. And I think it's tied in as well with Rod's side of things and Jordan's side of things in terms of presenting greens with a pure bent grass stand of grass on them rather than the poa. So I think agronomically there's an opportunity to improve things. But for us in particular, it's taking those greens, which are beautifully positioned in every instance, and just making them a little bit more interesting, I suppose, in the same style that Harry Colt would have done if he'd had that chance, you know, way back in the early part of the last century. So we're very excited by it. It'll be fascinating. You know, the players obviously love the course as it is. So our challenge is to make sure they love it even more when they come back in 23. And it's great that there's that opportunity to play it just before the project and pretty close to its completion. So we're extremely excited about the potential of everything at Hamilton.
I think that was a great line, Martin. Just from our perspective, this is really more about enhancement than change. I think you said it well, that everybody loves the course as it is, but I think the subtlety and the enhancement that we can bring forward in this project is going to just really top things off.
Good. And you know, just to give us a bit of background on our side of things, you know, we're very fortunate, based in the UK, but working on a lot of courses that Harry Colt and his partners designed, so that we think stands us in good stead. We hope that's, you know, one of the reasons the club selected us. We're very fortunate in advising 7 of the 10 British Open, or as we call it, Open Championship venues, Portrush being, I guess, one of the key ones. So that will be under the spotlight this year. So we're used to trying to get the very best conditions for the world's best players to play for that 1 week every 7 or 8 years. But we know that the course has got to be great for the members day in, day out. That's 99.9% of the golf played here. So that's uppermost in our mind.
Perfect. Ron, do you want to say anything?
From my standpoint, I'm the guy that looks after everything. So I understood the weaknesses over the years of our old greens. You know, basically from my being able to look after the golf course and going forward, there's a lot of infrastructure when you do a project such as this. So you know, our old greens, there's no drainage in them, and they were designed back in the early days when green speeds weren't anywhere near what they are now. And it's interesting because the restrictions to the green speed is paramount with the PGA Tour, and being able to present fair putting surfaces for basically 5 pin placements. And when we get some of the speeds up around here, like we would have for a member guest day or something, we're using that 1 pin placement, or even that very marginal pin placement that we may have. So from an infrastructure standpoint, the new greens will be more receptive to being able to spread wear and introduce lots of movement into greens for putting interest and get square footage. Same thing, this is Canada, and everybody's well aware of what winter can do to some of our golf courses. So some of the things that we can do when we're building new greens and new features to alleviate some of those things that happen when we get ice and snow up in this part of the country, I'm excited about that. So we can have a more consistent kind of a golf course going forward. And as well, the grasses that will give us, our members, more consistent playing conditions from the beginning of the year to the end of the year. POA is it has its moments. It has times when it's a very excellent putting surface, and it has its times when it's a struggle to keep smooth and those kinds of things. So that and on top of the irrigation system, which is just it's time to replace it. We need to replace our irrigation system, and our bunkers are past their prime, and they need to be replaced. And the club, as Chris kind of alluded to, when you look at all those things together and the amount of construction that's involved in just that, it really made sense to look at the greens as well and take and look at and do everything and make sure that we address everything and we set the golf course up for the very long future ahead. So I'm very excited about getting started on that.
Thank you. Thank you, Rod. Rod was also in charge of the golf course for our last Canadian Opens in 2003, 2006, and 2012. Every Open up to, and this weekend and week, golf week, Rod has done a fantastic job, as I'm sure you'll all agree. The golf course looks beautiful. From 2003 to 2019, the course just gets better all the time. There was also one instance in 2013, the winter of 2014. We lost all our greens. Rod said, I can grow them back. And he did. It took him about 2 months, and they were right back in great shape. And he's one of the best growers of grass in the country.
Well, he is.
Anyways, thank you. Anything else?
No.
Thank you, gentlemen. We'll open up for questions. Graham has a microphone, so he'll just pass it to you. You can pose a question to anyone. Just ask specifically for a person, or you can ask it to be open to anybody.
Thanks, gentlemen, for the great presentation. Martin, two-part question. First is, with the changes that are going to be implemented at Hamilton Golf and Country Club, how do you see the scoring being impacted? Because we see lots of birdies this week, and do you think we'll continue to see that in 2023?
I think quite possibly. Yeah, I mean, we're not... I think the venues we work on, back at home, for instance, the open venues, if the conditions are right, these guys will score brilliantly. They're fantastic golfers. So people enjoy seeing the talents of these great players, I think. What I guess we want to do is, off the tee, make them think a little bit more. You know, is a driver the right option? You know, bunker the course in a position where, again, maybe we're updating it from Harry Colt's original concepts. But there's a few more thoughts then in terms of, you know, what they should do off the tee. But then also up at the greens, you know, just give the guys setting the flags, you know, just a few more opportunities to make them tougher to get to, I suppose. You know, we've got some very slopey greens out there, as Rod's alluded to. So it's just a question of using that slope, but breaking it up into different areas on occasions. So I think, it'll be perhaps harder to get close to the flag on all 18 greens, put it that way.
And my second part is, you alluded to earlier about making changes to Royal Portrush. What sorts of changes do we expect to see, and the challenge that it presents for the best golfers in the world in less than a month or so?
Oh, at Portrush.
Yeah.
Well, we've got two new holes, two completely new holes, which had to replace the old 17th and 18th. So they are just on the most magical ground imaginable. And so I think... Yeah, previously the course has been, some people regard it as the best 16-hole course in the world. The last two were a bit disappointing. So when the RNA said we need those last two for the Spectator Village, fantastic news. You know, we've given two holes which really fit in with the other 16 on the course now, we think. So what else? I mean, I think the grasses on that course, there's our traditional fescue dominates through the greens. They should be able to present it pretty firm and fast, I think. Obviously, it depends on the weather conditions. And for that, you know, I think for any of these players, that is the ultimate test, is if the ball stops on the green, you know, if the green's like a dartboard, then it's relatively easy for them. When they've got to judge, you know, where to land the ball to let it run on, that's when it becomes a lot more testing. And hopefully, you then get the best ball striker come to the fore. So, it's going to be a tremendous festival. The landscape of Portrush is unrivaled, I think. You see the sea from every hole, I think, and the dunescape is the best of any of the open venues. I always have to be a bit careful because we have worked for Mr. Trump as well at Turnberry, and I say that's the most majestic of the open venues, but Portrush has the best dune structure, so I always have to make that qualification. But no, it will be, I think, a lot of the players will never have seen it. They did have the Irish Open there, but that's obviously a European Tour event, so a lot of the Americans and Canadians perhaps wouldn't have played in that. So it's a completely new course for them. But I think a bit like this week, it seems to have a feel-good factor. I was watching the coverage back in the UK on Thursday, and just the comments were glowing from everybody. So we have got a tough job on making sure that if anything, increases. But I feel the same way about Portrush. You know, just the Northern Irish people are the friendliest in the world, and... I think it will be one, a real party atmosphere from start to finish. So hopefully you'll be there.
No, I will.
Good. Yeah. Great.
Will you?
Yeah.
Nice. Lucky guy.
Hey, Sean. Sean.
Yes.
Oh, I'm over here. Over here on the right.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Beyond 2023, what are your goals with respect to hosting this tournament, and what does this work have to do with those?
We have no plans for post-2023. We are still on schedule to host the tournament again in 23 and look forward to that. But otherwise, I think if we get the improvement plan done properly in the next Open, I think we'll just probably take a rest for a while and let our members just enjoy this great place.
Okay, and one follow-up question. Yes. What's your budget for this work?
The budget is $11 million. And there's $1 million contingency included in that $11 million, you know, for loss of revenues in carts and guests and things like that.
Okay. 27 holes. Shorten as well, isn't it?
27 holes. So, you know, it's a lot of work. We're going to be probably, you know, originally the whole project came about because we were going to replace just our bunkers. And as Martin, you know, with Martin's plan now, we're gonna get rid of some of our bunkers. There's just too many of them, and they're kind of expensive. The upkeep is, you know, every time it rains, you lose your facing on the bunkers. And with Martin's expertise in design of bunkers, well, I think we can, you know, make them a little more playable and less maintenance. So thanks for your question.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Martin, we know that on the west-south layout, some of the greens aren't Harry Colts at all. Do you wander around and look and go, oh, that's not Harry Colt. How am I going to make that look like a Harry Colt? And if so, how many are there that you think you'll have to make changes in?
Yeah, I mean, you're quite right. There's a number of greens have been changed several times over the years, seven west, I think. Rod, maybe four or five
12.
Times,
yeah.
a lot of times, and you know, severe slopes on that green, for instance. So, I mean, Harry Colt wasn't, you know, beyond creating greens with fairly significant slopes, and as you probably know, if you've experienced a lot of his courses, but it's just making sure that that's appropriate for today's green speeds, really, to a certain extent. You know, Rod's alluding to 11, 12 on the stimp meter, so obviously big slopes mean reduce, you know, pin areas. But I think, you know, really, all the greens are in the locations that Harry Colt planned, apart from 6 South, which was got moved, didn't it? That used to was 15 as it's played now. So that's the only change in location of a green from Harry Colt's original layout. But as I say, I don't think, you know, there was the detail wasn't really applied for any of them in the first instance, and I think that's what Alison was alluding to in 1920 when he came and reviewed the course. You know, I think with these projects from these great Golden Age architects, it's fascinating to imagine how often they got to these courses. We're working in Japan at the moment on another Colt & Company course. Alison designed it in Hirono, known as the Pine Valley of Japan, is its moniker, and Alison was there for 3 days. So it was the guys that did the construction work who were so talented and really deserve probably as much credit as Colt, as McKenzie, as Tom Simpson, Stanley Thompson, all those great guys, because I don't think they could get there that often in those days. So, you know, here with the First World War intervening, it was probably difficult to get, you know, to focus on it and get the, you know, the right team constructing the course at that stage. So I think in a way, the way I view it is, you know, we're trying to imagine what Harry Colt might want to have put out there for every green on the golf course. You know, that's the next part of my design process, which is going to be fascinating. I love that side of it. And then even more enjoyable when it's being implemented on the ground.
One follow-up. We know the East 9 was not designed until about the 1950s. So we know that's not a Colt, but
74,
okay. I believe it was on your website, you said something about wanting to make that 9 look a little more like it fits in with a Harry Colt design. How would you do that with something that's just cut through the trees like that?
Yeah, I mean, I think if that was a 9 hole standing on its own, I think people, yeah, they'd be delighted with it. I think it really is a great 9 of its own right, really is. But, you know, clearly the greens are a little bit different, again, in style. So, you know, I think we can just tie all 27 greens together in terms of their design style. You know, through the trees, there are some there's more tree cover on that 9, but that is one of the proposals, in fact, is to open it up. And there's a lovely big triangle that, if it was cleared of trees and planted with fescue, would give a much more open feel, like Rod actually has achieved and Jordan has achieved in recent years. You know, this course was a lot more tree-bound, 3 or 4 years ago, and Rod quite clearly pointed out that that was causing huge problems with the green conditions, all the shade that was being cast. So this has opened up a lot more, and I think the same can happen on the east. Not to the same extent, but certainly there's opportunities.
And I can add to that, Gary, that we play all 27 holes in three different combinations. So we in effect, we play three 18-hole golf courses here for our members in daily play. So having a similar design on the East 9 just makes all three of those golf courses more harmonious with each other, and no matter what combination you play them.
You spoke to it already, actually, which is kind of one of the things I was going to allude to, is a lot of trees have been removed over the last few years, especially like towards the back of the front nine there and along the hill to kind of open up view lines. Is that something that's going to be continued to be worked on to help with turf conditions and the greens and all those things? Because as you mentioned, the bunkers and greens, but how many more trees do you plan on taking out?
Most of the trees that we took out from back in the last few years were directly related to shade on green surfaces and key, some tees, maybe a few landing areas, but a lot of it was the trees were that were planted back in the day. Poplars, willows, silver maples, very, very dirty trees, messy trees. So I can tell you right now, we're out there today with some blowers blowing some pollen that's coming out of trees. If we had those trees here for this open, I don't know how we would be able to keep up with the debris that would be coming out of the trees at this time of the year. So one of the part of it was to eradicate some of those dirty and invasive and quite frankly the size that some of them were dangerous with large branches coming out of them in windstorms and things. So that the side benefit of that was getting sunlight to the ground, and so it was kind of a reset. The club planted trees. There was a tree committee here and still is a very good, strong committee that is now constructively planting trees where we want them, but also removing trees still where they don't look proper. And as Martin, what's happened really in the removals is the reveal of the topography that was originally here. I mean, this is what Harry Colt saw when he came here 100 years ago. And the comments coming back from the members as a result of the tree works are exactly at the contours, the views, the vistas. It's a spectacular looking property, and you know, why bury it in trees? So carrying forward, there is a small amount of tree work remaining to do from a tree removal standpoint to be able to grow good quality turf on our greens. We're there already. There's not one of these green sites, and starting this project, one of my criteria was to be able, if we're going to plant bent grass and grow bent grass and have good strong greens, that plant needs a lot more light. One of POA's features is that it does survive a little bit of shade, and that's how it invades. It invades when other turfs get weak. So we have to keep bent grass strong to be able to keep the POA out going forward. And there's not one of these green sites I don't have full confidence we can have a good, strong bent grass green.
And speaking to the greens, for Martin, I know, Chris has talked about it as well. The square footage, is that something that plans on being enlarged on a lot of the complexes, or kind of keeping a lot of the detail work that we see now similar, but just changing the topography, as you say?
Good question.
Yeah, in general, the greens are being enlarged. What we've seen probably throughout most of the courses that we advise is that greens have got smaller over the years. It's sort of a natural thing which happens, or a man-made thing, but it just naturally does happen over the years. I think for Rod and Jordan to produce good turf conditions going forward, they need enough space, they need places to put the flag. But that's where, you know, we need to be creative in the designs of those greens to still make them challenging, interesting, fair at the same time, but you know, playable and maintainable. So there'll be an increase in size.
Good question.
Many of the answers have been specific, and that's great. But I'm wondering, for the fans in 2023, when they come back, will many of the fans notice differences, or will they look and say, "This is the same course that we saw in 2019"? In a broader scale from the specifics.
Mm-hmm. It depends on just their attention to detail, I suppose. When it comes to the greens, I don't know if they'll notice. Will they notice a different species of grass on the greens? Unlikely. Different contouring. I think if they've got a reasonable attention to detail, I think that might be the case. They'd appreciate that. The bunkering. I think the style of the bunkering will definitely be a difference that they'll notice. But the broad, as Rod said, you know, most of the tree work has been done. So I think from that perspective, you know, there won't be. You know, I think everyone beholds this great landscape, and let's not fool ourselves. It was a difficult one to route a great golf course around. The elevation changes are so significant that that's the brilliance of Harry Colt's original layout, done in a fairly short period. You know, he got all those par threes in the right places, and you know, you've got to walk up hills sometimes, but the holes themselves are all 18 outstanding golf holes. So there won't be any noticeable difference in that respect, because you know, no point in changing something that is so good.
But I could add to that, Martin, because one of the things I enjoyed through the process is, you're right, if you come back 4 years later, you may not remember every hole perfectly. But what we were able to see is sort of some before and afters that Martin was able to produce with technology. So the subtlety of the what it looked like before to where it is after was great to see just in the conceptual designs.
And Sean just mentioned, you know, the tee position side of things is a big part of the project as well. Yeah, you know, said this has to be for the members principally, and it's great that it will remain and be strengthened as a championship test. But with 60 positions, you know, there'll be a lot more flexibility in playing the golf course as well.
For sure.
Thank you, everybody. Everybody up front will be available if you want to chat with them after, and we greatly appreciate your time.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much. Thank you.